Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight we're going to start out with Lowell Steward, who died recently at the age of 95, and Lowell Steward was one of the last remaining Tuskegee Airmen. During World War II, Lowell Steward flew 143 missions for the all-black squadron in Europe. They faced significant discrimination during the war, but ultimately they were instrumental in the desegregation of the military by President Truman after the war. Later in life, when he moved back to Los Angeles, Mr. Steward helped organize and serve as president of the Los Angeles chapter of the Tuskegee Airmen and founded a scholarship foundation in their name. Here's one of his fellow airmen explaining what their role was in World War II.
Our organization was all black. There was no integration whatsoever. Our job was not to go out and seek and destroy enemy aircraft, but to make sure enemy aircraft did not destroy the bombers on their missions to the target, on the target, and then returning home. And what happened as a result of the discipline that was shown by the black airmen was that they stayed with the bombers to protect them. Enemy fighters were reluctant to come in and attack the bombers with the escort airplanes so close and ready to destroy them if they did come in, that there began to become a record of the bombers that were being protected by the red-tailed Mustangs that were flown by the black Americans were not being destroyed by enemy aircraft. When the war was over, the black group had flown 200 combat missions escorting heavy bombers throughout most of Europe, and they had not lost a single bomber to enemy aircraft. That was a record that never was broken or even achieved by any other escort group throughout all of World War II. It simply destroyed the myth of the incompetency of black airmen.
Well, it turned out before the war, Mr. Steward was a wonderful athlete in Santa Barbara. I thought I'd read you a little bit about that from the Santa Barbara papers and an interesting story about a chance encounter late in life. When it was time to die, Lowell Steward went peacefully and fearlessly, like the brave hero he is, said his son Lowell Jr. That bravery stemmed from the only time Steward was helpless in the face of adversity, when he was a standout player for UCSB, then known as Santa Barbara State College, during the 1940-41 basketball season. We had six guys who could really play, Steward told me 30 years ago during a reunion of the team. Most of us were rejects from big colleges because of our size. We played fast, no-look passes, behind-the-back passes, through-the-leg passes, and full-court press. Steward was a nimble 5'11 athlete who played center because of his jumping ability. He was a high-jump champion at Jefferson High in Los Angeles and won a conference title for the Gauchos by clearing 6'4". Utilizing quick moves to the hoop, he was the basketball team's leading scorer and rebounder. At the conclusion of a successful regular season, the Gauchos were invited to compete in the National Association of Intercollegiate Basketball Tournament, the nation's oldest and reputedly toughest collegiate tournament because it brought 32 teams together for a week of nonstop games in Kansas City. Santa Barbara had it tougher than the other 31 teams. Missouri was a segregated state, and the NAIB would only allow white players onto the court. The Gauchos had an African-American, Lowell Steward. Coach Willie Wilton sought his permission for the team to play without him. They deserved a chance to play for the national championship, Steward said. Steward made the trip with his teammates, but he was barred from their hotel and from sitting with them on the bench. He stayed at a YMCA and was sent to the colored spectator section in the rafters of the Kansas City Auditorium. He watched the Gauchos win three straight games to reach the Final Four, but they lost to Kentucky's Murray State in the semifinals 35-33. I suffered many years from that experience, Steward said. People say if I'd played, we'd have won. That makes me feel good, like I was worth something, but I have no way of proving I was any good. It's like a fantasy. Steward faced rejection again after the attack on Pearl Harbor. He and his teammates went to sign up for the Army at the Santa Barbara recruiting office. All the others were accepted, but Steward was told to wait. That enabled him to stay on as captain of the depleted 41-42 Gaucho basketball team. He graduated with a degree in physical ed. I had straight A's in science and mathematics, but nobody counseled me becoming a scientist until I was a senior. By then, it was too late. Determined to prove he could handle difficult tasks, Steward found his opportunity in the war. He enlisted in the Army Air Corps and was sent to a training base for aspiring black aviators at the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama. They said black boys didn't have the intelligence to fly airplanes. I joined the Air Force so I could explode the myth. When the Tuskegee Airmen got their chance to fly combat missions, they excelled, especially as escorts on bombing raids. We trained so long we were the best pilots they had. Steward completed 143 missions. We were athletes. The only thing that keeps you from flying is fear. Athletes are known to be fearless, willing to try something on the edge. We were taught acrobatics, rolls, and loops. We were the last of the seat-of-the-pants pilots. He practiced discipline in the air. White pilots were trying to see how many planes they could shoot down. I never shot anybody down. Our mission was to protect the bombers. We stayed in sight of them all the time. Hal Wilder was a B-24 bomber pilot who flew a terrifying mission over Germany in 1945. Nearing the target, his plane encountered a barrage of exploding flak. I was scared to death, Wilder said. I was seriously considering bailing out. Then he noticed a red-tailed P-51 fighter about 40 feet beyond his wingtip. He was normally surprised because both escorts and enemy fighters normally avoid the flak zone. He was a faceless pilot with an oxygen mask, Wilder said. He was doing slow rolls. He was playing games. Okay, I thought, if you can do it, I can do it. He got me settled down to do my job. Wilder, 96, told the story during a dinner at the California Veterans Home in Ventura. Stewart, who lived in Oxnard, was in attendance. Major Stewart was grinning and pointing to himself. He was that nut. The Red Tails had been based far north of our field. We had no contact with them on the ground. I had no hope of ever learning who it was who saved my honor that day. But what a coincidence to find it was my friend Lowell. Good story. Might make a movie someday. We're going to move on now to Joe Cocker, who died recently at the age of 70. And I'd be lying to you if I said I was a big Joe Cocker fan. Generally, I prefer I understand the words my singers are singing. But he did provide us with some of the most memorable moments in rock and roll. And people who know more than I say he's one of the great blues soul singers of the rock and roll era. He grew up in the Midlands of England in Sheffield. Like the Beatles, he was raised on Lonnie Donegan's skiffle, and he got his first start with Decca in 1964, and I'll talk more about that later. It was a failure. But later on in the 60s, he left his job with the East Midlands Gas Board, started singing for a group named the Grease Band, mostly Northern Soul, and in 1968, with a little backup help from guitarist Jimmy Page and Steve Winwood, he had a huge English hit with a cover of the Beatles with a little help from my friends. It wasn't a big hit in the United States, but it got him enough attention to get him a gig in April of 1969 on the Ed Sullivan Show. The highlighter that night was Connie Francis, so you could see how much things were changing. And he and the Grease Band did a cover of Traffic's Feeling All Right. Now, Joe Cocker used to flail his arms about, I don't know if it was drugs or what it was, and Ed Sullivan didn't want that on the show, so a la Elvis Presley, they hid him behind a bunch of dancers. I gotta leave before I start to scream. Put someone out the door and tell them to leave. And all right. I'm not feeling good myself. I know you're there, Lord. Yeah, Joe wasn't feeling all right because he did a lot of drinking and drugs. He lived a hard life. But not long after that, about 5 months later, Joe Cocker turned in one of the legendary performances in rock and roll at Woodstock, where he did a reprise of With a Little Help from My Friends. And no less than Ringo says, it's the best version that's ever been done, surpassing even the Beatles.
Well, I'm going to leave you with the usual thing. The only thing I can say, I've said to many people, is this title just about puts it all into focus. It's called With a Little Help from My Friends. Remember it.
Every old year that I sang you a song, I will try not to sing out of key. Oh, baby, how goodbye. Oh, I'm ready for what
check that one out on the film Woodstock. They love that one. And that got him a big American tour with some of the best musicians around, including Leon Russell. It was called the Mad Dogs and Englishmen Tour after the Noel Coward song. And he had a big hit album come from it, a film, and a couple of major singles. One was Delta Lady.
Woman of the country, now I find.
The other is a remake of one of my favorite songs from the 50s, Cry Me a River. And I would be remiss if I didn't play the definitive version from the 50s by Julie London. No one sings this song better than her, and no one was a sexier singer than her. Check it out.
Now you say you're lonely. You cry the long night through. Well, you can cry me a river, cry me a river. I cried a river over you.
Now that's good stuff. Here's what Joe Cocker and Leon Russell did with it 15 years later.
This is called Cry Me a River.
I know I'm a Philistine, but it doesn't make me forget Julie London. Anyway, for the next 5 years, Joe Cocker had a lot of trouble with drugs, alcohol, arrests, things like that. But in 1975, his career was salvaged by a song written by Billy Preston, another guy who hung around with him. I think his troubles made him shift from being a hardcore rock guy to more of a soulful interpreter. This song made it to number five, and he sang it all over the place. But by far, the most memorable version was again one of the legendary performances on Saturday Night Live early in the run of the show. He came on the Saturday Night Live stage, started singing it, and who comes on to start parodying him but John Belushi, who does a dead-on parody of him flailing his arms. And as with a lot of stuff John Belushi did, it's hard to tell whether it was a cruel parody or a loving parody.
Can't you see?
Whatever you think of Joe Cocker, he had two legendary performances, that at Woodstock and that one on Saturday Night Live. But I'd have to say the biggest of his career was 6 years later, when he really changed his image, and he sang a duet with Jennifer Warrens. They recorded a song for the 1982 Richard Gere movie, An Officer and a Gentleman, and Taylor Hackford demanded the song be used at the end of the movie over the objections of producer Don Simpson. Simpson said it was a lousy song, it wouldn't be a hit, but I think he was wrong. It went number one in November of 82 in the United States. It went number seven in the United Kingdom. It was certified platinum, and they won the Golden Globe Award for the Best Original Song and the Academy Award for the Best Original Song in 1983. It also won the BAFTA Film Award Song for the Best Original Song in 1984. Cocker and Warrens won the Grammy Award for the Best Pop Performance by a Duo in 1983 for their rendition of the song. On the American Film Institute's 100 Greatest Songs in the Movies in the Last 100 Years, it's rated number 74. So I think Simpson was probably wrong. Written by Buffy St. Marie, Jack Nietzsche, and Will Jennings, here's a little bit of Up Where We Belong.
Up is up where we belong. Where the eagles cry on a mountain high. Up is up where we belong. Up from the world below.
Well, that sort of cemented Joe Cocker's career. He straightened up as an act a couple years later and did a lot of touring. He's still not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and even though I'm not a big fan, even I can't understand that. I mean, come on, the guy did one of the most memorable performances ever in a live show, on television, and in the movies. If that doesn't get you into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, I don't know what does. I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT person, Sid Tepps. And as I said before, Joe Cocker started his career in 1964 with Decca. He cut a record most people don't know he did, and most people wouldn't recognize his voice even if they had heard it. It's a cover of a Beatle tune at the time. It's by far my favorite song of his. On this record is a guy named Big Jim, that's Big Jim Sullivan, whose podcast we've done, and Little Jim, Jimmy Page. Joe Cocker didn't like it, Decca didn't like it, and the fans didn't like it, but I think it's a great song, and I think it's better than the original. Before Joe Cocker changed his style, here's his cover of I'll Cry Instead.
I got every reason on earth to be mad. So I'll cry instead. I'll show you what a loving man can do. Till then, I'll cry instead.